glad I didn't skip that. I don't know what came over me. I must have just been seized by the Holy Spirit. So there was a gentleman who was a little bit hard of hearing, and he got a new job raking leaves at Camelback. And he shows up for his first day at work, and he forgets his hearing aid. And he's a proud man and does not want to tell anybody that he's having trouble hearing them. And when the foreman comes and tells the group of people, your job is going to be raking, your job is going to be blowing leaves, and you, sir, will be in charge of supplies. Man furrowed his brow and looked at the foreman with a bit of confusion on his face. The foreman says, supplies, points to the shed. He said, I'll be back in 2 hours. By then, you should have this whole lot cleared. So the foreman comes back and comes to find all of his workers standing around, and the gentleman hard of hearing nowhere to be seen, and all the leaves still in a pile. He says, what happened? Thought this would be an easy job. Where are the tools? What are you doing standing around? And the other gentleman said, well, the man you sent to get the supplies hasn't come back yet. We don't know where he went. And so the foreman, disgruntled, walks over to the shed to get the supplies himself. And the doors swing open, and the man hard of hearing jumps out and yells, surprise! That's awful. Well, I searched probably for about 20 minutes looking for a joke about surprises and finding ones that were clean enough to tell in church. So what's the point? God is really a God of the unexpected, isn't he? A God of surprises. And we see that all throughout our scriptures. From Genesis to Revelation, we see God is constantly taking what you might expect and flipping it right on its head. And we see that especially in the nativity narrative and in the story of King David, who we read about this morning, who Hillary read so beautifully about in our Old Testament lesson. And think about David for a second. David was crowned king by the Lord, but he didn't have any of the proper credentials, did he? He was the youngest in his family, and the youngest typically were the runt. Special honors like being anointed king, that was usually reserved for the firstborn. So already there's a reversal of expectations there. And he was a shepherd, you know, not a very glamorous job, not a very prestigious job. And yet this was the man that the Lord tapped to be king of his people, Israel. And then we get to the story this morning where the Lord approaches the prophet Nathan. After David comes to Nathan saying, it is not right that I live in a beautiful mansion of cedar, and the Lord and his Ark of the Covenant stays in a tent. So David has the idea that he will be the one to build this glorious temple for the Lord's presence, which is symbolized by the Ark of the Covenant, to dwell in. And Nathan at first thinks this is a great idea. The Lord's going to be very pleased to hear that you're going to build him a big fancy house, right? And the Lord comes to Nathan and says something surprising. He says, from the time I led my people out of Egypt, I have not lived in a house. I've lived in a tent. I've lived on the ground close to my people. And that is where I am content to stay. This is a God who prefers to camp in the dirt than to live in a palace. This is a God who prefers lowly shepherd boys over mighty lords and warriors. This is a God of unexpected choices. Well, you know the story. God eventually relents and says, okay, David, your son can build me a temple. And just like when the people came before God and asked for a king, the Lord says, well, what are you talking about? I'm your king. You don't need a human king. Eventually he relents and says, okay, I'll give you a king. And eventually he relents and says, okay, I'll give you a temple that you can come visit me in. You can see what's happening here. God didn't intend for the people to have a king, and God was to live among them in a tent, not tied to one geographical location, but ready to pick up and move with his people if need be. God wants to be close to his people. He wants his people to be ready to move. God's people were always meant to be a pilgrim people. But now by the time of David, God has already relented to the people's demands, and we can see how patient God is with God's wayward children. The people didn't like God's plan, so God crafted for them a plan B. And only God is able to take the foolhardy ideas of sinful humankind and fashion them into decent ones. But you know the story, right? Eventually, Israel reaped what they sowed. Throughout history, they had many wicked kings and many corrupt kings who led their nation into disaster. And the great and terrible nation of Babylon came and destroyed the holy city and took off many Israelites into captivity. And they destroyed God's temple, God's house. How could they do that? How could anyone destroy the home, the dwelling place of God Almighty? Unless maybe God wasn't home. Unless maybe God was back out in those tents with the Israelites being carted off into captivity. But that is how the Israelites felt, that God wasn't home, that God had left the building, and that they were abandoned. They had asked for human kings, and those human kings let them down. They had asked for a fixed place to visit God, and that fixed place was destroyed. It seemed to the Israelites that God was a liar, that he had broken the promises he made to David when he said, "Your house and your kingdom shall be made sure forevermore." But the people forgot. The people forgot that the king was only the king as God's representative, and that God remained the true king over them, even without a human to speak for him. God's kingdom remained even as his people were displaced throughout the world, because God's kingdom is one that was made to move across the face of the earth. God would not forget his servant David. For out of his lineage would come the greatest king of all. God would fulfill his promises made to David in ways beyond David's wildest dreams. And thus we arrive at our gospel text this morning. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town called Galilee in Nazareth, or a town in Nazareth called Galilee, to a virgin named Mary. First of all, the sixth month that Luke refers to here is the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy. Elizabeth is Mary's cousin, and she is pregnant with our odd old friend John the Baptist, the man called by God to begin the work of preparing God's people for the coming of Christ. From the beginning of this gospel, we see that God is continuing his age-old tradition of choosing the unexpected, the small, the weak, the overlooked. What is especially noticeable in this story is how the men, Joseph and Zechariah, are introduced as if they're going to be the main characters in this drama, but are very quickly outshined by the women. This is unexpected indeed, especially given the time in history that this story was written. God didn't choose the rich or the powerful, or those society deemed to be wise or important. God chose two nobodies, Elizabeth, a barren woman, and Mary, an unwed, pregnant peasant from a backwater town. With these two women, God was beginning the conspiracy of the ages. And so God arrives before Mary. "Greetings, O highly favored one." It says Mary was perplexed by what kind of greeting this is. You can feel her confusion. Favored? What have I done to be favored? I'm a lowly peasant. What is this favor you're speaking of? Never mind the fact that it is an angel who is appearing before her and saying these words. Add to her confusion a bit of terror at the sight of something so powerful. "Do not be afraid," is what the angel says to her, which is the most common phrase on the mouth of Jesus throughout leave all four Gospels. "Do not be afraid, the Lord is with you." And then the angel Gabriel gives Mary a seemingly impossible task. angel asks her to carry a child that will be born miraculously without a father. Now imagine how that's going to sound to her parents, to her neighbors, to her fiancé. This is a tall order, and one that could put Mary in a very precarious situation, because if she's accused of adultery, she might not only be put out and made destitute and outcast, she could be stoned to death. God is asking Mary, who's already one of the most vulnerable people in her society, to make herself more vulnerable in order for the honor of carrying the Messiah in her womb. But what does she say? Does she say, wait a second, I need to think this over? No, she doesn't give it a second thought. She says, here I am, send me. And so with the most unlikely of people, in the most unlikely place in the world, the divine conspiracy was hatched. To send a savior to the least expected place, through the least expected people, it had to be this way, because that's just God's style. God is a God of the unexpected. God is a God who sees the world upside down. Or rather, it's we who have turned God's values upside down. When God shows up, he changes everything. He flips everything on its head. When he shows up in your life, he either has or will soon turn everything on its head. He'll give you new eyes to see the world in upside-down vision. And that's really what the gift of Christ in the manger will teach us, if we are attentive to listen to the story. That God doesn't value the things that we value. God values the small people, the weak, the easily overlooked. This is good news for us, because I'm sure every one of us has felt small, insignificant, and overlooked at some point in time. But it's also a challenge, because all the wrong kind of people in our minds are all the right kind of people in God's mind. We will be an upside-down people, bearing God's word made flesh into this world anew. Thanks be to God. Amen.